Katrina Seaforth, and we are bumping out.
I am now going to assault your mind with subliminal messages.
Chapter 24, Jesus has just been crucified. The disciples are all despondent. Their leader was dead. Their hopes were dashed. Luke tells us two of these disciples were walking along the Emmaus Road, and Jesus appeared to them, but that Jesus had blinded their eyes so that they could not recognize him. He appeared as a stranger to them. Then Luke says he sat them down and opened up the Old Testament and showed them that the whole of the Old Testament pointed to what had just happened. The entire Old Testament pointed to this gospel that was being fulfilled before their very eyes. Then later he reveals himself and then leaves. But what is interesting is what the disciples said about the encounter after Jesus left. They had just been with the risen Christ, the Son of God, but what was on their minds? In verse 32, they say to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he opened to us the scriptures?" If the Old Testament scriptures caused their hearts to burn within them and he was right there with them, imagine how much they should cause our own hearts to burn within us, to long for him while we wait his return. The Bible says in, among other places, Colossians 2:17, Galatians 3:24, that the Old Testament scriptures are meant to teach us about Jesus, to show us a picture of him. When Matthew begins his gospel, he writes, "This is the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham." Jesus is all over the Old Testament, in some places more than others. Some places the picture is kind of dim. Other places, it is in high resolution. One of these places in the Old Testament where the picture is clear is in the book of Ruth. I mean, it's so clear you've really got to not want to see him there to not see him. It's the story of a kinsman redeemer. It's the story of a promised king. It's the story of a curse being broken. It's the story of reconciliation to God. It's the story of the gospel.
Ready to have some fun? Let's do it.
The book of Ruth. It's an Old Testament book. It's a really, really short book, too. So if you want to feel really spiritual this week, read all four chapters and you'll be like, yes, I'm holy now. Though it actually doesn't make you holy.
Actually, Ephesians 5:25-27. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. That he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish.
But it's fun to read through an entire book of the Bible. Let's start reading in verse number one, Ruth chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "In the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. So a man from Bethlehem in Judah, together with his wife and two sons, went to live for a while in the country of Moab. The man's name was Elimelech. His wife's name was Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem, Judah. And they went to Moab and lived there. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died. And she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah," not Oprah, "Orpah, and the other Ruth. After they had lived there about 10 years, the unthinkable happens. Both Mahlon and Chilion also died. And Naomi was left without her two sons and her husband." The title of today's message is "Breakfast is Ready."
Yingers, yee-ho, yee-hoo, 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 yee- Yeavers, beer, horn, beer, scare, bork, bork, bork.
This passage of scripture is easy to read and not feel. A lot of the Bible can be that. It can feel like it's someone else's story and not your own story.
The Bible's not about you.
But if you wouldn't mind today, I'd love for you to slow down just a little bit. And I want you to feel a little bit of what this woman would be feeling. There's a famine in the land, maybe similar to what's going on in Australia right now. There's a drought that's happening. A lot of people are hurting. We're praying and trusting God for that rain, and we're believing that this nation will be saturated with the rain of heaven for sure, not just spiritually, but also physically as well. But maybe there's a famine in your family. Relationally, there's a famine. Maybe you had to move out of your house. Maybe you right now are separated from your spouse. Maybe in your business, there's a famine. Maybe when you look at your bank account, there's a famine. Maybe you look at your relationships with some friends, there's a famine. And so it is with this family.
Well, no, it's not that way with this family. They are starving. It's not metaphorical. It's a literal starvation. But it's so much more than that. There's a famine in Bethlehem. Bethlehem means house of bread. There is a famine in the house of bread. Also, this man is from the line of Judah. In Genesis 49:10, the Bible says, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be." There's a promise of a king to come from the line of Judah. Now, this is the time of the judges, when darkness ruled the land of the children of Israel. The book of Judges says in this time that there was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in their own eyes. And if you read some of the horrible things people were doing in the time of the judges, it will give you an idea of what people without a king think is right in their own eyes. But Genesis 49, it said a king is coming from the tribe of Judah to rule the people. But now the tribe of Judah is dying. There's a famine in the house of bread. There is death in the house of Judah. What is going to happen?
So you got a husband, you got a wife, you got two kids, and things are not going well in their community. So they decide they're going to pack up and they're going to move to Moab. So they get in their minivan, they head up to Moab, and they get there and things seem to be going all right. And then Naomi loses her husband.
It's worse than that. Moab is a cursed people. So cursed that in Deuteronomy 23:3, God says no Moabite is to be allowed into the assembly of God. They cannot worship God with the people of God.
Again, if you just read that and don't feel that, it can seem trite. But every funeral that we have done of a spouse in our church, you look into the eyes of that husband or that wife that has lost their significant other, and there's an emptiness that can be there. They're trying to figure out, how will I live without this person? It's like their leg has been severed, and you don't just grow a new one. You have to learn how to live without your leg. And here, this beautiful woman, Naomi, she's lost her husband, but at least she has her boys, right? At least she has her two sons, and she can look at them and see glimpses of her husband, Elimelech. Maybe she sees it in a laugh, or she sees it in a smile, or she sees it in how they work, or how they walk, or how they sing. And then these two sons get married. So there's a couple of weddings that take place, and they do the Cupid shuffle like you might do at a wedding, and they're listening to all their Post Malone music.
Well, I doubt they were listening to Post Malone. Have you read any of his lyrics? They're pretty obscene.
Maybe even throw on some Hillsong, and they have a fantastic, fantastic wedding. And she's got her two now daughter-in-laws, and she can't wait for babies, because I've heard the best part about life is not being a parent, but being a grandparent. I have heard that. I don't know that to be true yet, and I hope I don't know for a really, really long time, Parker.
Her son's married Moabite women, cursed women. Their babies would be under the same curse. Who's going to save
them? She's looking forward to grandbabies. But she doesn't get grandbabies. What she gets is tragedy. 10 years later, her two sons also die. There's anything tragic for a parent to walk through is to have to go to the funeral of your own child. And to stand in those rooms, you can't put words to those emotions. So this woman, Naomi, has lost, she would say, everything. She's at the bottom of the barrel. She is crying huge tears. She's probably cried so many tears she can't cry anymore. Have you ever been to that place where you're just so emotionally spent? It's like you don't even have any more to give. You're so tired, you feel like dying. This is this woman, and maybe it's some of us that are at one of our locations or in this room today. Maybe you're at this place feeling like I'm at the end. I'm at the bottom. I need God, but it's like the world has turned its back on me. It's like God has turned his back on me. And Naomi is in the middle of this. And this is one of the things I love about the rawness of the Bible, of the honesty of the Bible. It does not paint a picture that since you know God, your life is easy and perfect. It paints a very real picture that you and I as human beings walk through this broken, fragmented world. But the good news is, and I think if Naomi was standing here today, she would tell you what I experienced in chapter 1 of my story is not the last chapter of my story. The God of heaven worked things out in my life in ways I never thought possible.
The good news is God fixed all my problems. But that's not the good news of the Bible. The good news of the Bible is that God fixes a specific problem. Only one. He solves one problem. But it is the greatest of all problems. It is the sin and death problem. It is the problem of the curse. Just like Ruth, a Moabitess, was cursed. And he fixes it through his own son coming in the flesh, from the line of David, from the line of Judah. See, the story begins with a famine in Bethlehem. It ends with the birth of David in Bethlehem. It begins in the dark ages. It ends as the light of life begins to shine. The light that would be revealed as the gospel of Jesus Christ, who came to save his people from their sins.
She would put it like this. If it's not good, it's not final.
Now, how do you know how she would put it? You're not adding to the word of God, are you?
If it's not good in your marriage right now, I'm telling you, it's not final.
It's you silly Jerry.
If it's not good with the relationship with your kids, it's not final.
But Jesus, you know, the one from the line of David, the one from the line of Judah, said that in Matthew 10:34, that sometimes the price for following him is enmity between you and the members of your own family. And we see this in the body of Christ all over the world. Many Christians are disowned by their families for no other reason other than their devotion to Christ.
If it's not good at your business right now, it's not final.
The same Jesus, of the line of David, of the line of Judah, said to his disciples, "Follow me." And the disciples left their businesses to follow him. How did that work out for them financially, I wonder? Well, what about Paul? He had a good business as a Pharisee before he met Christ. He went from a white-collar academic scholar to a blue-collar tent maker and stable boy. You know, all over the world, in places like North Korea, for instance, Christians are losing their businesses and their livelihoods because of their devotion to Christ.
If it's not good in your mind right now, if you can't sleep at night, I'm telling you, it is not final. The God of heaven always has the final word, and his final word is always, always good.
2 Corinthians 11:23 through 28, Paul here seeks to defend his devotion to Christ, and he does it by listing a list of things that he seems to think are normative for the servant of Christ that he endured. He says, are they servants of Christ? I am more. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged more severely, and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was pelted with stones. 3 I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I have been constantly on the move. I have been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I have known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Besides everything else, I face daily the pressure of my concern for all the churches. Do these preachers even read the Bible? I don't think they do.
He can't help but be good. That's all that exudes out of God.
That's true, but he's still good even if your marriage doesn't get better. He's still good if your kids don't turn out right. He's still good if your business goes bankrupt. He's still good if you don't finally get a good night's rest. He's good all the time, and all the time he's good.
All that exudes out of him is grace and love and mercy, and he is more for you than you're for yourself.
And because of that, he is conforming us into Christ's image. Romans 8:31, I assume that's what he's paraphrasing. If God is for us, who can be against us? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, in all what things? Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, sword. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Here, this beautiful woman, Naomi, ends up going back home. She hears the famine is over. She starts heading home, and they hop in that same minivan that they drove up to Moab in, and she's now driving back with her 2 daughters. And they stop, and Naomi tells them, you need to leave me. Go away. It's like I'm cursed.
She thought she was cursed by God. She seriously believed that. And guess what? She was right. We are all cursed by God. We are all under the curse of sin. But there is hope. That's what this beautiful little book of Ruth is about. That's what it's a picture of. Naomi is cursed in the land of the cursed, and yet God is going to raise from her family a king who would become a curse for her. Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. This little book is all about Jesus. Maybe this preacher will get around to talking about him.
Everyone who's connected to me dies. Every business I touch fails.
She didn't say that. You're playing fast and loose with God's word there, preacher. That's not good. It's not good at all. This is about the promised king of Israel, not our business endeavors.
Every relationship I have, it ends terribly.
This is not about you getting a girlfriend, either.
Just leave me. Maybe you have some friends like this in your life.
Not about your peer group, either. It's about Jesus, our kinsman redeemer, our promised king.
They won't come to church with you, because they're thinking the building's going to fall in on them.
You know, just as an aside, people say that all the time. If I come to church, the roof might fall in on me. and we laugh, but it might just happen. I mean, it happened in Jesus' day, Luke 13, verses 1 through 4. There was some present at that very time who told him, Jesus, about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And he answered them, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Or those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish."
They're thinking something that's good for you can't be good for them, because everything that was ever good for them always turns out bad.
There, now it's ours.
This had enough brokenness in their life that they start to think that their life is all about brokenness. As a matter of fact, Naomi's name means pleasant, but she changes her name from Naomi to Mara. It means bitter. Can I encourage you to not let your valley rename you?
Boy, we didn't see that one coming from a mile away, did we? Don't let your valley rename you. You know, I'll bet when the children of Israel read this story about the coming king, they thought, the main thing here is to not let your valley rename you. Imagine a mother teaching her children, looking through the storybook, the picture book, as it were, of the Old Testament. In the first century, to see pictures of their Jesus, who had gone, ascended to the Father, to intercede for them. They're looking through the picture book and this book of Ruth, and the mother says, "Kids, the important thing is to not let your valley rename you."
Can I encourage you to not let your dark place rename you? Can I encourage you to not let the pit that you're in rename you? Can I encourage you to not let that one Saturday night when you were in high school to rename you? Can I encourage you to not let that one season of your life when you made some of the dumbest decisions you've ever made to rename you? Some of us are sitting on the sidelines and not getting involved in church because we've allowed a season to rename us.
Are we? You know, that's the most important thing to these kinds of pastors. You getting involved in church, getting involved in their vision, not exalting Christ. If exalting Christ was important to them, they would do it instead of making every passage of Scripture about getting involved in church. And by church, they mean their church.
We're thinking, I can't serve on the worship team. I can't be a host. I can't serve with the kids. I can't do any of these things because I messed up here and I messed up here. And if they knew who I really was, there is no way that they would ever allow me to be a part of this family. And you come in late and you leave a little bit early. But I want you to know, we see you and we know you and we love you already. And even though you've renamed yourself, we still see you as a son and a daughter of God.
See what I mean?
That's the spirit of this house.
This is at Hillsong Church, by the way. They're not interested in exalting Christ. They're interested in you, specifically in what you can do for them. And it should be noted here in Ruth that no Moabite person was allowed into the assembly of God. No Moabite person was allowed into the family of God, into the church, because they were cursed. If only there were a curse breaker who could come and remedy that for us.
So this woman has renamed herself bitter, and now she's trying to push people out, or push people away from her. Trying to push people away. She's trying to push people away. She's trying to push them away.
Imagine the first century Christian mothers in the midst of real persecution, reading this picture storybook to their children. This story of a kinsman redeemer. This story of a promised king to lead his people into the family of God. And she goes, it's important not to let your valley rename you, kids. And also, don't push people away. Now get in there and make that coffee for the 9:30 service.
Why? She doesn't want to hurt anymore. She's gone to too many funerals. I don't want to go to another one. Now she's trying to push people away. But you can't get close to me. Don't get close to me. Don't get close to me. So now I'm being mean to you, not because I don't like you. It's actually because I love you so much and I don't want to hurt again. So if I push you away now, that way at least I can control my pain, because I can't take another one coming out of the blue.
Naomi was trying to control her pain, kids. But Mom, Pastor Timothy said the story was all about Jesus. Yeah, what does he know?
And Orpah decides to leave. She says, I'm gonna go back. I don't want to be single forever. I don't want to be by your side forever. I'm gonna go back. But Ruth, I like her. I like Ruth. She's like, you can't get rid of me. You're stuck with me. No, leave me. Nope. I'm not going anywhere. You can try to go this way. I'm going that way. You go that way, I'm going that way. If you go two more steps the other way, I'm going with you. If you go five steps backwards, I'm going with you. You cannot get rid of me. Where you go, I go. Where you stay, I stay. Your people will be my people. Your God is going to be my God. Don't you love friends like this? Don't you love those friends that are like, you cannot get rid of me?
I want to get you to try being creative on canvas. Just to take your time and sit down. Have nothing in mind when you start. Just have a good feeling and be happy and in love with the life and your world, and sit down and begin playing.
I'm thinking about a guy in our church. He lost his mother, and he went into such a pit of depression, rightfully so. He loved his mom so much, she lost a battle with cancer, and he was so involved in church, on the front row, serving, you know, just a part of the community. He lost his mom, and he just kind of became a recluse and went to his apartment to have his shades down all the time. And I was so grateful every Sunday morning, but not just on Sunday mornings. Every single day, somebody was at his house, knocking on the door, saying, "Sorry, Adam, you can't stay there. Sorry, Adam, you got to come out. Sorry, Adam, we love you too much. Sorry, Adam, you can't push us away." That's the type of church Hillsong is as well. You just got to have a place where you got some people that go, "You can't get rid of me. I know you cussed at me. I don't care. I still love you."
Isn't Hillsong Church great?
Ruth says, I'm staying. This is what the fire does in your life too. The fire actually exposes those people who are meant to be with you in the next season.
You see, kids, what the book of Ruth teaches us is that the fire is meant to expose who is meant to be with you in the next season. But Mom, Pastor Titus said, never mind what Pastor Titus said.
Because you know every person is not for every season. Every person is not for where God is trying to take you. Some people were perfect for when you were thinking like this. But they are not ready for when you're thinking like this.
You see, kids, Orpah was perfect for Naomi when she was thinking like this. But she wasn't ready for when Naomi was thinking like this. But Pastor Timothy said this is all about Jesus. Sweetheart, everything can't be about Jesus. Some things have to be about us.
Some friends of yours are perfect for when you're just playing church. But some of your friends, they will not handle when you want to show up early and you want to stay late and you want to give money and you want to lift your hands and now you want to wear a t-shirt and now you want to invite me to a conference and now you want to give your time. They're not ready for that right there. They're okay you being lukewarm. They're not okay you being on fire.
Church. These preachers, that's what they preach. That's all they preach, church. But not just any church, their church. Well, they can have their church. I prefer Jesus' church. My King, my kinsman redeemer, the one who died so that I could belong to his church.
And I'm letting you know, some of those friends will need to fall by the wayside. Not because they're bad and you're better than them. They just can't handle the next season that God is bringing you into. Stop holding on to people that God is trying to shake free from your life.
Sounds kind of cultish, doesn't it? Kind of disassociate yourselves from those people who don't believe in your vision. And what if one of those people is your spouse? Didn't you just say that God is going to make your marriage work out? Now you're saying God is trying to shake people free from your life because they don't like you wearing a Hillsong t-shirt. Which is it, preacher?
You don't have to demean them. You don't have to disrespect them. You don't have to look down upon them. Matter of fact, you don't have to add them on Instagram or Twitter or anything. You just keep running your lane and doing what God has called you to do. You keep being who God has called you to be. And you look by your side and see those who are willing to run right alongside of you.
Keep showing up early to church. Keep staying late. Keep volunteering for the parking crew. Keep making that coffee. Keep giving money. Keep wearing that t-shirt. That's what the Book of Ruth is all about, isn't it?
For a quick aside, you know, single people, if you're wondering, is that person right for you? Are they the one that you should marry or not marry? Should you keep dating them or not dating them? The question is, look at your pace. And if your pace is a strong pace and you're looking to your right and that person is right there with you or maybe a little bit ahead of you, that's probably somebody you want to hold on to. But if that individual is sitting by the wayside over here, huffing and puffing, let them get their lungs a little bit stronger before you try to rescue that person.
What about, I don't know, are they a Christian? Have they been redeemed by their kinsman redeemer? Do they belong to the king God has set in Zion? Now, are they keeping up with you? That's the big thing. When you show up for church early, are they there or are they still sleeping in late? These are the kind of things you gotta watch for.
They come into town. And Ruth and Naomi find a go home. They go back to the land that Elimelech owned, and they're there, and they've got their ice cream, and they've got oversized sweatshirts and Lululemon leggings on, and they're watching Netflix, maybe your movie, watching Netflix. I went like this, because I wasn't sure which person it was. You, yes, you with the cool hat. Yeah, thank you. All of you producers here.
Is all this necessary? I mean, how does this aid in the exegesis of the text of God's word? It's the time the preacher could be spending talking about Jesus, but he has chosen not to. He's chosen instead to talk about Netflix. And I wonder why that is.
Or they're watching reruns of The Office. And just eating the ice cream. And some of you post-conference are like, that sounds really good right now. That sounds really good.
Bring us the Bible.
But Ruth says, I can't. Oh, boy. Oh, I gotta go. She's one of those people, you know, their knee is jumping up and down. They're sitting next to you now, and it's like, it's like they always got to be going. It's like, hey, we're just going to chill. We're going to relax. You go on vacation with these kind of people, and they just want to do excursion after excursion after excursion after excursion. You're like, oh, that's not me on vacation. I'm telling you right now. I'm working on my tan on vacation. I am sitting back. Just so you know, black people do get blacker. So I'm sitting there.
That's crazy!
Relaxing. But some people are like, whoa, no, I gotta go. And that's Ruth. I think she has that kind of temperament. She's like, no, I gotta go. I gotta do something. I can't sit around here for, Mom, I love you, but I can't sit around here for, can I go get a job? And she's like, go. Go get your job. Mom, I'm coming back, don't worry. I'm just gonna get a job. And then Ruth gets up and she goes and finds a job. Goes around from place to place to place to place. Or maybe she didn't. The Bible actually says she showed up in one particular field. But this field was strategic. It seems like it was kind of on accident. Like from her perspective, she thinks I chose this field. She does not know that the God of heaven is actually orchestrating her steps. And the God of heaven actually closed some doors so that he could guide her to the right place at the right time. Ah! The steps, not just the journey, but the steps of a good man or a good woman are ordered by the Lord. That God is actually directing your steps. Maybe you think you chose Hillsong Church just because you're like, oh yeah, I want to go there. But actually God said, no, I'm going to lead and guide you to the exact place where you're going to be planted and become all that God has called you to be.
Ruth is a picture of God's plan to redeem his people, to set his king in Zion. It's not a picture of Hillsong Church. It's not about God's plan for your life. It's not about your destiny. It's about Jesus. The Bible is about Jesus.
I'm going to unlock my purpose and my destiny on the inside of you when you get planted in that life-giving place.
Hillsong is a life-giving place. We've heard more about Hillsong than we have Jesus, the author of life, the giver of life, the kinsman redeemer who brings dead sinners back to life. I don't think this preacher said anything about Jesus yet, but he said quite a lot about Hillsong, hasn't he?
So she finds herself in this place thinking, I just chose it, not knowing that God's got a bigger plan in the midst of all of it. And she goes to work, y'all. She goes to work. She's a hard worker.
Whoa, I'm a painter.
I like Ruth. Okay, she's a hard worker. Matter of fact, the owner of the company shows up. His name is Boaz. He shows up. Quick side note, Boaz is a cool name. Okay, and if your name is Boaz, you're cool. You cannot have a name Boaz and not be cool. On the other hand, if you have the name Earl,
Pastor, could we have more Bible?
I met some Earls in my day. I'm like, dang, that could have been me too. And I'm not too far from being.
Give us Bible.
Earl is too much of a name for a baby. Okay, I told my mother this. I said, Mom, why would you name me Earl?
The word of God.
It was your father's name. It's your grandfather's name. I know, Mom. I get that. But they're grown men, okay? You cannot name a baby come out of the womb. Wah, wah. Earl. It's too heavy. It's too heavy.
Cry out to the pastor. Bring us the Bible.
It's decent now, but as a baby, it just does not work at all. Boaz shows up. Cool name. Strong name. Owner of a business shows up and he sees this woman over there working. He's like, what? It's in the Bible.
Sure. You know what else is in the Bible? The Gospel of Jesus Christ, specifically in this beautiful little Old Testament book of Ruth. But we're not going to talk about that, are we, Pastor?
That's amplified or message or something. Girl, who is that over there?
I don't know whether to laugh or vomit.
He doesn't talk to her first. He talks to her supervisor. He says, hey, who is that? Supervisor says, you can read this. This is in chapter 2, verses 6, 7, and 8. Supervisor says, oh, that's Ruth. Man, she's amazing. Matter of fact, she only took a short break. She's been working all day. It's like she showed up early, stayed late, and when everybody else was taking really long breaks and complaining about how hot it is out here and so upset that they had to do all this stuff during harvest time, she just keeps on grinding. She just keeps on working. She just keeps on going. Everybody else is over here moaning and complaining, but she's there's something different about her.
The text, you know, God's word doesn't say any of that. There is, however, a very godly discourse of courtship here that goes on between Boaz and Ruth in chapter 2. You should read it. Young men today could take a lesson from it.
She's just going and going and going and going and going and going and going. And then Boaz says, really? And she's fine? Let me talk to her. So she comes over, they're having a talk. So now here is this factory worker. Here's a woman that was on the floor of the factory. Now she's talking to the owner of the company and they're having a one-on-one and everybody else is like, what in the world is going on there? Why is he talking to her? And now he's having this interaction. He's like, hey, matter of fact, want to come have lunch with me? She's like, what? I'm going to have lunch with the owner of the company? You ever been let into a place? You're like, how in the world did I even get in here?
So pick up a brush, a pencil or pen. If you don't like this one, paint it again.
And she goes in and sits down, is having lunch with the owner of the company. The owner then is like, hey, drink whatever you want, eat whatever you want. As a matter of fact, he has a bunch of bread, passes it over to her. Ladies, if you're ever on a date with a man and he passes the bread all the way over to you, that man is into you. You better not let that man go. So now they have this interaction and it's amazing. Then he sends her back to work on the field, but tells the people in front of her, hey, whenever you pull your wheat, I want you to drop a little bit extra on the ground for her. So now Ruth is out there doing her job, picking up this barley that's falling on the ground, and she's picking it up, and there is tons on the ground for her. Now, it's possible for Ruth to think, I'm so awesome, there's never been a better barley harvester than me. But she does not know that her boss actually talked to somebody else on her behalf and has now positioned her perfectly to receive something she could not have received on her own. And this is what God has been doing for you as well. Listen, you're wonderful and you're great and you're fantastic, and I know your grandmother loves you.
You're cursed, just like Ruth was cursed, just like we were all cursed, which is why we need a kinsman redeemer to save us.
But please understand, God has been better to you than you deserve. He's been better to me than I deserve as well. And we're all picking up some extras.
But I could find freedom on this canvas.
Here's a quick aside. This woman, Ruth, she's actually working in a field that one day she's going to own. But she doesn't know she's going to own it. She does not know. What she is doing is she's just grinding. Here's a principle I want to make sure we all get. Favor follows hustle.
So, you see, kids, Ruth worked hard. She hustled, and Boaz showed her favor. Favor follows hustle. But, Mom, Pastor Timothy said this was about Jesus. No, it's about favor following hustle. And, you know, that's not favor. That's payment. Favor is unmerited, Pastor. They cover this in Gospel 101. I guess they don't offer that class at Hillsong.
Favor follows hustle. Because she was willing to show up, because she's willing to grind, because she was willing to give 110%, because she was willing to stay early, because she's willing to stay late. It's amazing how doors of favor opened up to her. It's amazing how some extra ended up on the ground. It's because she was willing not to go halfway, not willing to give just a little bit. She actually went 110%. I just want to encourage you, go 110%.
When you buy your first tube of paint, you get an artist license. And that license says you can do anything that makes you happy.
In everything that God has called you to do, everything from being a father, to being a husband, to being a mom, to being a business owner, to being on a team, you give 110% and you watch how the favor of God follows that.
That's not favor. It's called a paycheck. But see, the story of Ruth is about unmerited favor. It's about grace. Is about God providing a kinsman redeemer for one who was cursed. God didn't tell Ruth, get out there and give it 110%. Make that coffee. Greet those visitors. And then I'll provide you with a kinsman redeemer to remove your curse. No, that's not the gospel. Maybe it is at Hillsong, but it's not the gospel according to the Bible.
Don't live with the bondage of trying. I don't want to overcommit.
I thought he was going to say bondage of sin and the curse. Ah, who am I kidding? I knew he wasn't going to say that.
Okay, let me get into this just real quick. Okay, real quick. I'm almost done. We talked about this a little bit at our master class at conference. Once you become a Christian, you already overcommitted.
What we learned from the story of Ruth, children, is the danger in overcommitting yourself. But Mom, Pastor Titus said, go to bed.
Because what Christ is calling all of us to do is more than any of us can do on our own. So you don't have to live with the mindset, oh, I don't want to serve at church because I don't want to overcommit. My friend, you gave your life to Jesus. You decided to pick up your cross and follow him. You decided to die daily. Since you've already gone that far, you've already gone all the way. So why not just go ahead and throw yourself fully at the cause of Jesus Christ and give yourself fully to every single thing that is put in front of you, and you watch how the favor of God follows that. So now the favor of God is all over her life. She ends up now with this relationship that she's about to have with Boaz. Okay, now I want you to look with me in chapter 3 verse number 18. I want you to look at this. It says, then Naomi said, Wait, my daughter. Everybody say, wait. Wait, my daughter, until you find out what happens. For the man will not rest until the matter is settled today. Chapter 4, verse number 1. Meanwhile, Boaz went up to the town gate and sat down there just as the garden redeemer he had mentioned came along. Boaz said, come over here, my friend, and sit down. So he went over and sat down. I want you to see chapter 3, verse 18, Ruth is waiting. Chapter 4, verse number 1, Boaz is working. Chapter 3, verse 18, Ruth is waiting. Chapter 4, verse number 1, Boaz is working. She's waiting, he's working. She's waiting, he's working. She's waiting, he's working.
Like we're waiting for the return of our kinsman redeemer, our promised king, Jesus, who worked on our behalf, who removed the curse from us. That's who we're waiting for.
My awesome 14-year-old Parker for Mother's Day in May. I think it's in May here in Australia as well. Mother's Day. You always got to honor moms on Mother's Day. There's no doubt about that, right? So Parker, I wake up and I see Parker in the kitchen. Okay. He is in the kitchen. Stove is on. Okay. So he's a teenager and fire.
Pastor, can we have fewer stories about your children?
But he's got some eggs on that skillet. He has got some toast in the toaster. He has taken out some strawberries, cut them up so finely, and put them around the plate. What he is doing is preparing breakfast for his mom. He says, Dad, I love mom. I just wanted to make her breakfast in bed. So he takes this plate filled with toast and filled with eggs and filled with strawberries. He goes into the room. His mom is still sleeping. She wakes up to something that her son had prepared for her. Go with me to Genesis. Go with me to Genesis. Go with me to Genesis. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 3, says there was evening and there was morning the first day. There was evening and there was morning. Go with me to chapter 5, verse 5, verse 5, chapter 1, verse 5.
I'm at verse 5. Calm down. He has to act like he's about to reveal some deep secret in the Word of God or something.
There was evening and there was morning the second day. Go to verse 13 now. There was evening and there was morning. When you keep going down in Genesis chapter 1, you keep seeing there was evening, then there was morning. There was evening, then there was morning. There was evening, then there was morning. And that was called a day. Notice it does not say there was morning, then there was evening.
He's right. It doesn't say that. My mind is blown.
It's as if we're getting a little wink that the God of heaven is saying, my day starts at night and ends in the morning.
I can paint the kind of world that I wanted.
Your day starts in the morning and it ends at night. So put another way, when you go to sleep, that's actually when God goes to work. When you lay your head down at night, this encourages my heart so much because I'm a goer as well. I want to get things done. I want to make things happen. But the God of heaven is saying, listen, I know I've given you gifts and talents and abilities, and he's done the same thing to you. Every single one of us, every single location, he has given you gifts and talents and abilities, and he wants you to work. Yes, but there comes a point in time you can't do anything on your own. What you need is the power of God. And what God does to release his power many times is says, I need you to stop. I need you to wait. I need you to put your head to rest. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to work on your behalf while you're sleeping. And then when you wake up, you will see what I prepared for you. I'm getting scrambled eggs ready for you. I'm cutting up strawberries for you. I'm getting a husband prepared for you. I'm getting a business ready for you. I'm getting campuses and countries and nations prepared for you. And if you'll sleep soundly, just know I have not stopped working at that time.
Again, this story in Ruth is about Jesus. It's not about your job, not about your campuses. It's about salvation. It's about the gospel. It's not advice on how to get a good night's sleep. This dude will make this about anything but Jesus. He's going out of his way to make it about anything but Jesus. You really have to want this to not be about Jesus to make it not about Jesus. But why would he do that, do you think?
Hey, I'm all done here, Ben. You can come on up. You can come on up. Our last verse of scripture, it's found in chapter 4, verse 13. It says, so Boaz took Ruth and she became his wife. When he had put on Bruno Mars.
Pastor, Pastor, could you tell us less about the culture?
The Lord enabled her to conceive. She gave birth to a son. Verse 17. The women living there said, Naomi has a son. They named him Obed. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. Wait. Time out. So Ruth and Boaz have a son, and they name him Obed. And Obed has a son, and they name him Jesse. And Jesse has a son, and they name him David. And then generations later, the Savior of the world will show up. God will put skin on, and all of humanity will be saved because the Son of David has come into the world. You're telling me that God took all of the tears and all of the pain and all of the heartache and all of the misery and all of the loss that Naomi went through, and he said, I will still have the final word over your life, and you're going to hold in your arms one day someone that will be connected to the Savior of the world. This is what our God does. He is able to make all things work together for good for those that love him and have been called according to his purpose.
At the end of the sermon, like 30 minutes in, and like as a footnote, the preacher throws Jesus in. He's like an after dinner mint, you know. He's like a toothpick. He's not the focus of the message.
He has not forgotten about you.
Then he goes right back to talking about you.
You keep on grinding, you keep on waiting, you keep on sleeping, you keep on serving, you keep on loving, you keep on giving, you keep on doing everything that God has called you to do. And you watch the generations that are on the other side of your obedience.
We take pictures very seriously, don't we? I mean, just make a goofy face in any bride's wedding picture and you will soon incur her wrath. You know, if you asked to see a picture of my family and I showed you a picture of a litter of puppies, well, what would you think that I think about my family? Or if I showed you a picture of my actual family, my wife and children, and said, here you go, here's a nice picture of a litter of puppies, you wouldn't think that I think very much of my family. You know, God takes pictures very seriously, too, especially pictures of his son. In Numbers chapter 21, God killed Moses for presenting a distorted picture of his son, for distorting the picture of the rock from which the water flowed, which was a picture of his son, Christ. Jesus condemns the Pharisees for presenting a wrong picture of him from the Old Testament scriptures. In 2 Corinthians, chapter 11, God sends sickness and death into his own church because they were presenting a distorted and perverse picture of the Lord's Supper. He takes pictures of his son very seriously. And we who are redeemed by him, who are bought by him, who are saved by him, who have life and everything in him and through him, we should take pictures of him seriously too. Especially preachers of the Word of God.
It's a lot of fun.